One of the biggest difficulties in life is going through day to day and feeling like you as an individual are struggling with the basic achievements, struggling to achieve the basics of your day to day due to difficulties that may be financial, that may be health, and sort of to deal with your health and so on and so forth, and it just may be the environment that you are in. But no doubt every single person in this dunya faces an element of difficulty. Why? Because the promise that Allah Azza wa Jal has made. And Allah Azza wa Jal describes the status of the people when they first enter Jannah. One of their first things that they say is Alhamdulillah alladhi adhaba anna al-hazan. Alhamdulillah. Praise be to Allah Azza wa Jal. What are they praising Allah Azza wa Jal for? Out of everything that they can potentially praise Him for, is that Allah Azza wa Jal has moved away from them all of the sorrows of this dunya, all of the difficulties of this dunya, all of the sadness that had faced them up until that point. And then they say, oh Allah Azza wa Jal, our Lord is the most appreciative and our Lord is the most forgiving. And then when they thank Allah Azza wa Jal for settling them into Jannah, they go on to say, الَّذِي أَحَلَّنَا دَارَ الْمُقَامَةِ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ لَا يَمَسُّنَا فِيهَا نَصَبٌ وَلَا يَمَسُّنَا فِيهَا لُغُوبٌ. Allah Azza wa Jal has settled us into this paradise, this place of eternity. What do they describe this place of eternity as? That fatigue will never touch us, tiredness will never touch us, nor will we ever be worried or weary in terms of our state, our mind. We will never be in a weary state. This is some of the first things the people of Jannah ask Allah Azza wa Jal and thank Allah Azza wa Jal for. Which goes to show that even the people that make it to Jannah have faced difficulties. Let's look at some of the companions or some of the prophets that Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in the Quran. We look at Ibrahim alayhi salam and we look at his story. Difficulties upon difficulties. From his difficulty in his relationship with his father first and foremost, we look at his father, he was someone that Ibrahim alayhi salam looked up to. He was someone that even when he addressed and chose the best of words. He didn't say, oh my father. He didn't say, ya abi. He says, ya abati. And if you were to translate it, it would be, oh my beloved father. This is when he is addressing his father after his father has belittled him. And then as the cycle of life continues and comes in his turn being a father, Allah Azza wa Jal tests him with his son and says, slaughter your son. Just as a test. To see how he responds to this test. And his response is, Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. And Allah Azza wa Jal has put me in these situations. And he has a sense of acknowledgement. If this is what my Lord has wanted, then this is the way it shall be. We look a bit further into the life of Musa alayhi salam. Before his birth, there were difficulties. His mother faced difficulties even having him. Why? Because Fir'aun would kill all of the children that were born on certain years. And after his birth, he faced difficulty staying in his household. As a baby, as a toddler, he had to live in someone else's household. And then when he grew up in his youth, he faced difficulty and had to leave his town. And when he left his town and walked a far distance away, and after he helped the two ladies, he laid back and he said, oh my Lord, oh Rabbi, my Lord, verily, inni lima an'amta ilayya min khayran faqir. I, with all of the blessings that you have given me, I'm still poor, I'm still in need. And if we were to think and compare the state that Musa was in then, alayhi salam, to what we are in now, very few of us would say what we have compared to Musa is true difficulty. He was homeless, without no source of income, with no partner. Yet he turned to Allah Azza wa Jal and he said, Rabbi inni lima an'amta ilayhi makhayrin faqir. After that, Allah Azza wa Jal brought back the two girls. And they said, our father was impressed and he wants to reward you. What was his reward? He offered him to marry one of his daughters, to work for him for 10 years, and that he will cover where he stays. Immediately Allah Azza wa Jal rewarded this by easing his difficulty. And that brings to the first practical advice and how any of us could get through difficulties, how any of us could live through difficulties, is we look at the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's left many du'as and many gems for us to pick up and learn from. In a du'a that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu narrated that he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say multiple times. He said, O Allah, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan, wal-'ajzi wal-kasal, wal-jubni wal-bakhl, wa ghalabati ad-dayni wal-rijal. He said, Oh my Lord, Oh Allah, making dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Anas ibn Malik is saying the best of mankind used to make this dua. He'd say, Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from stress, from sadness, from feeling ajz, which is feeling like you are unable to do something, and kasal, laziness, and jubn, to be scared of something, or to be a coward. And then he will say al-bukh, which is stinginess, and ghalabat al-dayn wa qahr al-rijal, that I will be outweighed by either debt that I borrow from people and I'm unable to pay it back, or that men outpower me, or whatever man it is in any circumstance. We look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we know he was the bravest of men. Yet he used to ask Allah Azza wa Jal, and he would seek refuge from Allah Azza wa Jal, that, Oh Allah, protect me from cowardness. He was the most giving individual that anyone could ever know. And he would say, Oh Allah, protect me from being stingy. Why? Because he put the measures in place from the start to make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. Oh Allah, help me avoid this. Oh Allah, protect me from this. And Allah Azza wa Jal answered. And for that to be a reality, we have to work on our relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about dua as one of three things. He says, either it is something that you will get answered immediately, or it's something that Allah Azza wa Jal will give it to you in kind. As in, you ask for something and Allah Azza wa Jal will give you something different that you needed more than the first thing. Or it gets delayed and held up until a later stage. Maybe later in this dunya, maybe in the akhirah. However, many people say that we've made these du'as. I've made du'a to Allah Azza wa Jal, yet Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't answer. In a hadith, in the 40th hadith of Imam Nawawi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about a man and that asks Allah Azza wa Jal and makes du'a, but his income is haram. What he's eating is haram. What he's dressed with is haram. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Anna yustajabu lah." How can his du'as be answered? If our lifestyle is haram, if we are making du'a to Allah Azza wa Jal to provide us something that isn't halal, how can we expect Allah Azza wa Jal to answer our du'as? If every single Muslim looked at his relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal, got up and prayed his compulsory prayers, and made sure that when he prays his salah, he has a direct relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal. When he's reading while paying attention to what he's reading. And then when he goes down to sujood, makes dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, with his heart ever present, with his mind ever present, Allah Azza wa Jal will answer our du'as. However, many of us, even when we are making dua, we are thinking about something else. Thus, many of us have left dua altogether. So the first answer to it is, seeing how this relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal is, and then based on that relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal, asking Allah Azza wa Jal to help you. The second one, and I'm not going to take too long, so I'm going to leave you with the second one, is finding companionship that is willing to help you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a believer is a mirror for another believer. And if there is something that you see in a brother, you should be his mirror, you should tell him. However, similarly, if you feel like something is not right with you, if you feel like your hair is out of place, or something may be on your shirt, you go to see your reflection. So you go to your brother, you go to your sister, you go to another believer, and you see your reflection. And based on that reflection, a believer will give you advice. The companionship is one of the most key components that will drive someone towards Jannah. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says on the Day of Judgment, Al-Akhillau yawma idhin ba'dhum li ba'dhin adu illa al-muttaqeen. Companions on that day are an enemy to one another, except the people of taqwa, the people of righteousness. Companions in this dunya are people that are going to pile on stress while you're stressed, or they're going to be people that lift that stress off you when you're in times of need. So choose your companions wisely. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who he surrounded himself with, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, people that he felt if he was ever to be absent, they would fill for him. Because a woman came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked, "Oh Messenger of Allah, I have a question for you." He answered that. And then she said, "I'm going to come again later." In some narration she said, "Next year, if I don't find you, who will I ask?" He said to her, "Ask Abu Bakr or Umar." The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his closest circle teach us the categories that we need for our companions. And we see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even in his darkest hour, he was with his companion in a cave, seeking Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect them